Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Kent. I am Reverend Stephen, your settled minister. It's good to be together once again. Thank you for joining us this morning as we gather in person and on Zoom, a spiritual community seeking to be diverse and inclusive as we inspire love, work for justice, and grow together in community. We extend a special welcome to visitors. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. It would not be Thanksgiving without me telling my favorite story about it. But oddly enough, it's about a parrot. I know. You know, what's a parrot got? Well, you'll find out. So there was a man who needed some company and had always liked birds, so he went to the pet store and was told by the owner of the pet store that he had this parrot who was incredibly intelligent, fascinating to actually talk with, so the guy bought the parrot. Brought it home. What the pet store owner didn't tell the man was that this parrot had a really nasty mouth. And he got the bird home, and he has his first dinner party, and the parrot is just saying things that you cannot say in church on Sunday. Okay, maybe this is an anomaly, but then as it goes on, the parrot starts insulting the guy and using foul language. One morning, the guy has had it. The parrot's mouthing off. He grabs the bird, opens the freezer, and throws the parrot in the freezer, closes it. The chattering goes on for a little while, and then it stops. The guy thinks, oh my gosh, I've killed my parrot. This is terrible. Well, he opens, and the parrot's still alive, chattering, freezing, and everything. And the guy says to the parrot, I hope you've learned your lesson. And the parrot says, I'm sorry, forgive me. It'll never happen again. The parrot warms up, and a little while later asks, so what did the turkey do? That's what a parrot has to do with Thanksgiving. All right. We are a people that practices radical hospitality, welcoming one another, making space and inclusivity for everyone. In that spirit, let's take a few moments to greet each other and check in. Talk to each other, okay? Once again, welcome. Now, let's take a moment to breathe and be present as we enter into our time of community once again. Let's invite the Spirit to be present among us and to open our hearts to life and the gift of this day as we reflect on what gratitude means in uncertain times. Come, let us worship together.
This morning, we gather to celebrate Thanksgiving, a day where we are invited to remember that we have much to be thankful for, even in these uncertain times, even as we experience struggle and loss and sorrow in our lives. We are also invited to be mindful that this is also a time of mourning, specifically for those whose land was forcibly taken from them. And so we acknowledge this morning that Kent, Ohio, was built on the unceded ancestral lands of the Shawnee, Seneca, Cuyahoga, Delaware, Wyandot, Ottawa, and Miami nations. So how do we find gratitude amidst the turmoil, injustice, and sorrow of yesterday, and amidst the sorrow, injustice, and turmoil that is today? I wonder what you might find here this morning to inspire gratitude in you. I wonder also how you will use it. As Unitarian Universalists, we light a flame within a chalice to unite us in worship, to remind us of our ongoing search for the light of truth within us and among us, a light to guide us on our shared journey, and a reminder that we are all interconnected in the great web of existence of which we are all a part. As Ray Lynn joins us to light our shared chalice, I invite you to light your home chalice. Please join in our chalice lighting words that are printed on the screen. We come together to remind ourselves to treat all people kindly because they are our brothers and sisters, to take good care of the earth, because it is our home, to live lives full of goodness and love, because that is how we will make this world the best place it can be.
Most, if not all of us, have heard the Hallmark version of Thanksgiving. Pilgrims came from England in 1620, landed at Plymouth Rock, celebrated the first Thanksgiving wearing funny hats and buckled shoes as they ate turkey and pumpkin pie and became the first Americans. After which the Native Americans said, "Well, this has been fun, but look at the time. We know you have a long voyage back to England, and just zoom in for this celebration next year." This story of Thanksgiving, complete with my spin on it, is a romantic Victorian myth, or as author James Baker put it, marvelous nonsense. Here's the real story. On November 20th, 1620, a small ship named the Mayflower landed at Cape Cod. There were 100 men, women, and children on board. They had expected to arrive 300 miles south in Virginia. Their sandy beach spot near Provincetown was not good for starting a settlement, so after several weeks, they sailed across the Cape Cod Bay to Plymouth, where the mainland had forests and was more protected. Their first winter was hard. Food was scarce, and no fruit or vegetables were available. Almost everyone got sick, and half of them died before the spring. William Bradford, the first governor of the colony, wrote, "So they died, sometimes two or three a day, and of 100 and odd persons, scarce 50 remained. And of these, in the time of most distress, there were but 6 or 7 sound persons, who to their great commendations be it spoken, spared no pains night or day, but with abundance of toil and hazard of their own health, fetched woods, made fires, dressed meat, washed clothes. Without the help of the local Wampanoag Indians who gave the pilgrims food during the winter and showed them how to grow native corn, the colony would have perished because of starvation and disease. The following summer brought an abundant harvest, and once it was in, the pilgrims decided that in spite of all their suffering and grief and struggle and loss, to have a festival to express their gratitude to God and to creation. They held a celebration for 3 days for themselves and invited the native people's chief Massasoit and 90 other Wampanoags to participate. William Bradford wrote, "Our harvest being gotten in, our governor sent 4 men out fowling so that we might, after a more special manner, rejoice together after we had gathered the fruit of our labors. And although it may not always be so plentiful as it was at this time with us, yet by the goodness of God, we are so far from want that we often wish others partake of our plenty." My colleague Scott Alexander wrote, "It seems to me that what makes the real Thanksgiving story so remarkable is not the joy which the pilgrims and Native Americans shared on that day, but rather that their painful backdrop of grief was not allowed to block out their celebration. Somehow, they were able to choose gratitude over bitterness, generosity over greed, thanksgiving over self-pity." Thanksgiving became an official holiday in this country in the midst of the Civil War. In 1863, the nation was divided, and the war had already taken the lives of 500,000 people. It was during this time of suffering and grief and struggle that President Abraham Lincoln proclaimed, "I do invite my fellow citizens to set apart and observe the last Thursday of November next as a day of thanksgiving. And I recommend they do also, with humble penitence for our national perverseness and disobedience, commend to God's tender care all those who have become widows, orphans, mourners, or sufferers." Not parades and festivities, but commending to God's care all those who are suffering, as well as giving thanks. These stories of Thanksgiving set in times of uncertainty, struggle, and hardship inform our service today. All of us in the course of this year have suffered losses, experienced grief, met with struggle and difficulties. We'll name these in a moment to acknowledge that suffering is real and that life is hard. In this sacred space, we'll hold one another in care, sharing our burdens with each other, commending one another into the care of love. This is some of the most important spiritual work for us as a community on this day. But equally important is that, like the pilgrims and our nation during the Civil War, in a time of loss, of grief, of suffering and struggle, we also take time together to be grateful, to give thanks, and to remember that each one of us are truly blessed in so many ways. Now together, let's take time to name and share losses, grief, fears, struggles. If you're on Zoom this morning, please use the chat box. We send care and healing thoughts for Trudy's mother-in-law, Beck, who starts radiation treatments next week. We send her prayers for Ann Andrews as she recovers from surgery. We remember and grieve for those who were wounded at an LGBTQ+ club in Colorado Springs early this morning. We hold in our hearts David Weaver's mother, who is recovering from a fall with broken ribs. Raven, prayers in this day of remembrance for all transgender individuals. Kevin also offers a Transgender Day of Remembrance, remembering at least 32 trans people who were killed in the last year, and now the 5 dead and 18 wounded in last night's shooting in Colorado Springs. We have other griefs, fears, worries among us. If you didn't fill out a yellow card, I invite you to speak those out loud now. For our divided nation in these times. Let's enter now into a spirit of prayer and reflection. Spirit of life and of love. In the spirit of thanksgiving, we hold before you one another and all of life. We pray for peace and for comfort for all who struggle or are suffering, those who grieve, those dealing with a loss of any kind, especially those in this congregation, our families, friends, and loved ones, and all who are part of a circle of love. We pray this morning that you will open our eyes to the suffering around us and help us join in the work of easing that suffering and caring for each other. On this Transgender Day of Remembrance, we hold in our hearts and remember all trans people who have been the victims of violence, especially those whose lives have been taken, and we pray for the safety and well-being of every trans person. We also pray that in spite of our struggles, our grief, our fears, our worries, our losses, and the hard moments of our lives, that we will find gratitude and give thanks for this earth, for the food it provides, for the beauty of the world around us, and for our lives, the greatest gifts we have each been given. May it be so, and together may we say, Amen.
This story, The Gift of a Raspberry, is inspired by the recollection of Goethe Weissmann Klein, a survivor of the Holocaust. Adapted by Martha Dallas. Once there was a place that was bleak and dreary. All the colors were only shades of gray and brown. Nothing grew there. No grass, no flowers, no trees. And this place was surrounded by walls and fences. People lived in this place every day, and every day they were forced to work, digging holes and shoveling dirt, and then shoveling the dirt that they had just dug out back into the same holes. This work made them tired, and their bodies hurt, and they felt hopeless, for their work never amounted to anything. The food that they ate was just a little bit of bread and broth, so their bellies were never full. They were always hungry. Plus, they were sick a lot, for this food wasn't nutritious enough to keep them healthy. At night, they slept, if they slept, on hard wooden beds. They had no pillows or blankets. They were cold, and they shivered most of the night. When they did sleep, they had bad dreams. And when they woke up, they were just as tired as they had been the night before. In this place, a girl went out, and suddenly she saw something on the ground. Something special and precious. It was a raspberry. Quickly, she picked it up and slipped it into her pocket, and she kept it safe there all day. And that night, she found a leaf that had a brown, that had blown in from the outside. And she put the leaf in her hand and placed the raspberry on the leaf and went to her friend and presented it to her friend as a gift. And her friend received it. I tell you this story not only because it does remind us that in the most sad, hopeless, and bleak and dreary places, we can, if we keep our eyes open, find miraculous surprises, treasures that are bright and sweet and delicious, like a raspberry. But more importantly, when we find these treasures, we can give them up. We can give them away. Give them to a friend. This story is true. It actually happened. And I want you to remember this story. So today, we brought some raspberries. Would Andrew and Evie help me with this part? So we're going to invite you to come and take one. When you do, I want you to return to your seat, hold it in your hand, and take a moment. And when everyone who wants one has one, we'll tell you what to do next. So we'll go pew by pew. Come up and receive your raspberry when the rooms are ready to hand it to you. Please don't put your hand in the basket. That's why they have gloves on. So we'll start with the first pew. Now, holding your raspberry, imagine that your world is sad and hopeless and dreary, as in the story. It's not a big leap sometimes to feel sad and dreary and hopeless in these times. But also imagine that your friend has given you this. This raspberry, this single, perfect raspberry. This raspberry was the one thing that your friend truly owned. And they chose it as a gift to you. Close your eyes with me. Once your imagination takes hold and the raspberry, you see the raspberry as the gift that it is, I invite you to enjoy your raspberry. Enjoy the gift that has been given to you. Taste as though you've never tasted a raspberry before. And always remember. I'll end with this quote from Goethe Weissmann Klein, who was given this raspberry. Ilsa, a childhood friend of mine, once found a raspberry in the camp and carried it in her pocket all day to present it to me that night on a leaf. Imagine a world in which your entire possession is one raspberry and you gave it to a friend.
This reading is titled The Deep Thanksgiving of Our Souls by the Reverend Dan Schatz. We need thanksgiving not only because it gives us cause for humility, but also because it gives us perspective that we might otherwise miss. It is thankfulness for a good meal, even when food is scarce. It is thankfulness for small steps toward peace, even in a time of war. It is thankfulness for the distance our society has journeyed toward justice and freedom for all, even when there are many miles of that journey still to go. It is thankfulness for the good in one with whom we have quarreled. It is thankfulness for the grass that grows through cracks in the sidewalks, for the robin that sings in the city slums, for the sun that yet shines, the sky that is yet blue, for the resilience of life, for the beauty of a child. The real spiritual discipline of thanksgiving is not to ignore suffering, but to fully acknowledge it, work to alleviate it, and yet still give thanks. It is to find reason for gratitude even in pain or chaos. It is to look deeper into the fabric of our world and see blessings where we thought none could exist. True thanksgiving is born of hardship as much as of joy, for it is in hardship that we realize and appreciate the foundations of our lives, the community and spirit that keep us going, the smallest blessings now thrown into relief, the tiniest seeds of hope that unfold in us when we thought all hope had fled. True thanksgiving looks at life in its fullness and finds reasons for gratitude. There are as many ways to express our gratitude and our grace as are our human souls and human thoughts. Words are unnecessary. We do not have to say anything or do anything, although there is much that we could say and do. All that we need is the calmness of gratitude, the wonder of a moment, and the deep thanksgiving of our souls.
Our second reading this morning is The Peace of Wild Things by Wendell Berry. When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free. Let's take a moment to be still and silent and focus on what sets you free. What are you grateful for? What brings you joy? Let's take a moment to focus on those things. As we come out of the quiet together and we're thinking of the things that create a feeling of gratitude inside of us, what are the things that give you a sense of wonder? What are you most grateful for? What makes you smile? What restores your faith? What fills your heart to almost bursting? take a moment, we took a moment to think about those sources of gratitude. And now we will share them in this space. We're going to do it in a very specific way, though. As we reflect on the gifts that bring us life, joy, and peace, we're going to create a prayer of gratitude for the gifts of life that fill us with wonder. And we're going to fill this room with our joy and with our gratitude. So when I ring the chime, I might ask you to close your eyes. Sometimes we feel a little freer when we're not looking around, thinking people are looking at us, right? So if we close our eyes and be in the moment, we could do that when I hit the chime. We're just going to speak into this space. We're going to put it into this space vocally, the things that we are thinking about that bring us joy and gratitude and peace and love, so that our voices create a patchwork of thanks for these gifts that fill us up. If you're on Zoom this morning, I will add your voice to this sanctuary. So feel free to please type into the chat box what your gratitudes and joys are, and we will add them to the chorus, to the prayer. So let's fill this space with all that brings us life. When I hit the chime, you may begin. And the prayer will not end until we are finished. There is no time limit for these types of things. Thank you for praying with me this morning, and thank you, Spirit of Life, for the mystery and miracle that is our connection to this life, to each other. We are grateful. Amen. Blessed be.
The story that Colleen told us reminds us that even in the hardest of times, there are still gifts we can give. And a sign of our gratitude is to share what we have with others. It is in the spirit of gratitude that we share our abundance with this community so that together our life of worship, of community, and ministry thrives. This is possible for all of us because of your generous gifts of money, time, and the way you care for each other, especially recognizing that we are all connected. Thank you. We also help others in our community thrive with our generosity by giving to agencies and organizations in Kent and beyond that serve those in need. For the month of November, we are taking a special offering for Kent Social Services. This is our local nonprofit organization that is dedicated to enhancing the nutrition of low-income people in the Kent area with the Hot Meal Program, a food pantry, and many other services. In the spirit of gratitude for the gift of each other and this community and the abundance that makes generosity possible, we now give and receive the offering as a sign of our shared commitment to the life and work of this congregation and beyond. Would the ushers please come forward and receive the offering? It's time to bring our worship to its close. Would you please join me in extinguishing the chalice? We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. May we carry these in our hearts and minds until we are together again.
In the corner.
This week as you leave, please take a look at the table outside. We do have gifts for children who are in the foster care system. That we are collecting for Christmas. So if you'd like to purchase a gift for a child, there will be an angel tree right outside those doors starting today.
Thank you. Thank you. Reminder to self, read the e-news. I offer you these words of Richard M. Fuchs. For the sun and the dawn which we did not create, for the moon and the evening which we did not make, for food which we plant but cannot grow, for friends and loved ones we have not earned and cannot buy, for this gathered company which welcomes us as we are from wherever we have come, for all our free churches that keep us human and encourage us in our quest for beauty, truth, and love, for all things which come to us as gifts of being from sources beyond ourselves, gifts of life and love and friendship, we lift up our hearts in thanks this day. And now, remembering that there is so much to be thankful for, including one another, this community and life with its struggles and achievements, its gifts and blessings, let us go forth in peace and in hope as we continue to inspire love, work for justice, and grow together in the community. May it be so. Blessed be. Amen. And wishing you a joyful Thanksgiving.